trying to manage the universe according to his needs. He is spending hours and hours and hours trying to see how the whole thing works. This is how he discovers the fact that time and space, which we thought to be absolute, is not really absolute. He didn't have any pre-idea, he didn't have any pre-notion. When he discovered, he himself was highly surprised. Okay? But the same Einstein, when his, in fact, I saw there is a play, it's a very nice play.
Yeah, it's a nice play.
He himself was saying that when my wife, or I don't know, somebody was dying, he said, I was so busy with my equations, I didn't even go to see her. So that means he's extremely philosophical, brilliant man, outstanding genius, okay? But what? When it comes to some simple thing like going and seeing your wife when she's dying, even that the person is, and then he regrets, like any other person, okay? What the spiritual aspect means, this Vedanta that you are studying is not for gathering information, as I told you, oh, which my ear comes from where and all. It's not for that. You need to re-understand who you are. You need to re-understand what is the nature of the cause of the universe. You need to re-understand what's your relationship with the cause of the universe. Based on this re-understanding, what? You have to behave differently.
You exercise.
You understand
choice.
The world differently and you behave differently. This is what makes it spiritual. Because the world, as we see it, there is erroneous perception. The perception is right, the conclusion is erroneous. So the whole teaching is to make you see where you make the mistake and help you, what?
Realign your...
Exactly. Realign your thinking in keeping with what is. The whole attempt is like that. Because when you start with a basic assumption, which itself is a highly distorted assumption, and you try to solve the problem, there is no solution there. In order to solve the problem, you have to change, you have to realize your error and shift it. Okay. So therefore, as long as you attribute what? The characteristics of the body on awareness, you are making awareness, which is free, highly limited.
Could you give us an example of what you regularly? For example, one of the attributes.
Okay, so that means
fat.
When you think, okay, now simple thing like I am fat. Okay, now the whole what? Now I give this whole that I what is the mistake I have made? On awareness, there is no distance between the awareness and
physical body.
The physical body. The physical body means sense. Okay. Now, with this, I live in this world. Okay. I go to a party which is supposed to be what? For my enjoyment. Okay. But while I'm getting ready for the party, I'm constantly what? Oh, I'm looking fat, I'm looking bad, I'm looking this, I'm looking that. So that means my mind is totally obsessed with this particular thing that now I'm fat. When I go to a party, it is meant for my entertainment. Please understand, it's not, I'm not giving it a value, good or bad. It's, I'm not telling you that, oh, when you become spiritual, you stop going to parties. Never. I never say things like that. This party is meant for enjoying. Nothing is wrong. Right? What happens? Why something which is meant for your enjoyment becomes a burden? Why? Right? Because now with this notion that I'm fat, I'm fat, I'm fat, you go to a party, when you meet somebody, where is your attention? You're not spending any time with this person, trying to just, you know, exchange or whatever. Your whole attention is what? Who's come?
Who's looking at me?
Who's now look at that girl, she's so slim. right? Oh, and you constantly, that slim, beautiful girl constantly reminds you and reinforces what? Your inadequacy. Okay? Then you get jealous. Because then you can't stand when somebody else, and then because when somebody is reminding you of your smallness, then you get jealous. Then what? You have to put the person down. Because when you are small, then what? In order for you to feel better, what do you need to do?
We get
put somebody else down.
You go into delusion.
So you keep on loading. First thing started with simple mistake, which is you take yourself to be attributes of the physical body. Then it doesn't remain a simple mistake. It gets loaded and loaded and loaded, compounded mistakes with which you are totally entangled. There is jealousy, which is coming from there. There is feeling of inadequacy, which is coming from there. There is a tendency to criticize, which comes from there. Then you think that, oh my God, you know, oh, then maybe that I'm getting less attention. You know, all kinds of, oh, my husband is looking at her. All kinds of problems. You load and you load and you load and you load. Then that affects your relationship with your husband. It is like so many repercussions. One simple mistake gets multiplied manifold. Then, what are you trying to do? You're trying to control your husband. Then, what happens? You don't take care of your own self-image. Because your self-image is confined to what? This physical body. That means all your other talents, all your other skills, all your other endowments are underutilized because there is one obsession. See the distortions within distortions within distortions. Then the whole world becomes one. Then you need to get drunk. Because you can't stand all these limitations and all that.
Best to stay with me.
Because it's too much.
I'll stay with you.
You need to forget yourself and you enjoy. Because with you and all the complexes that you're carrying within you, there is no freedom. A party is gone. Parties are made for you to enjoy. It becomes source of problem. And that's why people say, oh, I hate going to parties. You hate going to parties because you can't enjoy with the mind that you go. You're not able to enjoy. You load every event, right? Every human being, wherever you are. If you go with your mind, you can, what? Make anything miserable. Because you keep on loading further and further. This is how. We don't know how to. And then, we then think that, oh, you know, the world is bad. Or poor me. Okay, or all these, it's just incredible. We are all bunch of complexes. One way or the other. Okay? In order to free oneself, you first have to realize the reality. I'm not giving you positive thinking. I'm making you see what is variable and what is that invariable. See that. That invariable is already free. It's a fact. Once you understand that relationship between you and the body, which is you are already free, does not mean that you will not want to be slimmer. It's okay. But in fact, when you have that freedom, where you are not, your self-image is not, entire self-image is not dependent on the fatness of the body, what will you do? You can help yourself even better. You can take care of your body better because all these complexes which was loading you, what you are freeing yourself from. Then you do what needs to be done. Okay? And at the same time you recognize that this is not the only aspect of physical body, has so many different aspects. Enjoy them, use them, okay, to have a proper relationship with physical body and mind. Physical body and mind is a privilege that is given to you. It becomes what?
Limited when you
live. It becomes a curse because you have a mistake. You have mistake. You make a mistake. And you compound that mistake. And you reinforce that mistake. The life becomes entangled.
That's the first mistake. How is this different from the second mistake? The first mistake is the attributes get...
Yeah, then all these complexes, jealousy,
yeah. No,
and
the
all
second
this.
One is what? That you say the awareness is the body, isn't that the same?
No, it's limiting awareness that you believe awareness is only limited within the body and
exactly.
Mind.
So what is that mistake? What is the next one was explained?
Yeah.
Can you give us an example?
Yeah, that mistake is something which you need to know about the nature of I. Okay? Nature of I, it is like this, right? This space seems to be confined to the glass. Awareness seems to be, even though it is distinct from body and mind, it seems to be what? Confined to this body and mind. Then what happens is, if I tell you, A, you are limitless, this is typical California self-help. Right? Your sense of I remains in this body, that you are some awareness, right? And that awareness, what, is totally free and it is limitless. Okay? So that means something which is limited, which is what, here, you impute on it and the whole universe will work according to your needs. You ask for it and the universe will conspire to give you what you are looking for. Is it true?
That's the alchemist.
Doesn't work like that. So that means what happens is, this is what we call wrong understanding of Vedanta. Because you think that you understand you are independent of the body and mind, and then you think that this awareness is still here. You localize that awareness and then you start thinking what Vedanta is saying is, it's limitless. So you continue the error, right? And then you become more what? Not in touch with reality than before. Because you retain your awareness here. It's like this glass.
You retain the
this space.
Of your
exactly. Life. You retain the, you know, if you this glass you. Starts thinking that this space is limitless.
Oh, I see.
It's not. This glass thinks that this particular space is limitless. Is it?
No.
No.
So the analogy with the second mistake is that? You think the
that
awareness
I continue to keep this awareness within my body and mind and start thinking that this awareness is
limitless
in this physical state.
Exactly.
Limitless or limited?
Limitless
in the limited physical
exactly.
Space.
Exactly.
So you try to confine your awareness when actually, you know, because you've localized it. So I think that's what
exactly.
It was saying. Like.
So that means you localize something and you continue to localize it, and then what Vedanta says is that this awareness is not something which is particular to you. It is all pervasive. You still continue to localize it and imagine that it is limitless. That is a big mistake.
It's more dangerous.
It's more dangerous. And
it's
it
like
is more
irresponsible. Superman.
This is why Vedanta, exactly, it is more dangerous than being a normal, normal a human being with a normal mistake.
By this we don't see oneness, but if we remove that, then we start seeing oneness.
What is the connection?
Because we know that it's not localized.
So what are the typical thinking mistakes coming out of it?
So, I think what she's been saying is that when you define yourself at a very base level, right, just limited to your body and mind. Okay, so I am fat, so my entire self
that
image
was the
is negative.
One.
Right? That's the first. But the second one is that in your pursuit of awareness, right, if you make the mistake of localizing that awareness within
the
limited body and mind, then your pursuit of it is going to be in the wrong direction.
Yeah, it's only
because that's
it's not
only. But I'm not able to translate it in. I'm not able
thought
to
patterns.
Huh?
Thought patterns.
Yeah,
thought patterns. Exactly. That this awareness is limitless. Therefore, I can do whatever I want.
So, like what?
Okay, that's
Mithali
okay.
said about the sentence from
so
the.
So that's
alchemist.
Wrong.
That's wrong.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
What should it be? This awareness is limited.
No, then you have to understand nature and the laws that govern nature, and then understand that you change your behavior. You can't say that you, in a facetious example, you can't say that I'm limitless and I want to fly, so I will fly. You can't fly. You know,
you have to understand
that the limit, the five elements, how they apply to you and the fact that.
What was that thing?
It's not a real confinement. But it still continues to be there. When this glass space understands that actually what space is not localized, it is fundamental. The as though confinement will still remain or not.
Like this is a
will it remain or not? It'll remain. Right? But the person is not fooled by the appearance.
Awareness is limitless.
You see what I mean?
This
is exactly. The awareness will be available to you through this body and mind. But through this teaching, you have freed it from this artificial
confinement. In a compromised position.
Right? So you are not then thinking that this is and then thinking that it is. You see what I mean? Big danger.
So it's limitless, but but it has a relationship with everything else, which is made up of five.
Exactly.
Inside of the
awareness is something which is in and through everything.
Right? Limitless, but works according to laws.
Exactly.
Inside of the limitations of the laws.
So therefore, this is the next. If we can come to the verses, this is exactly what it says. Right? So now, what we have seen is two things. Okay, two things is the whole universe made up of five elements, different permutations and combinations, and second is awareness, which is pervading. Yes? It's okay. Now, who is an individual and what is Ishvara is explained. So let's see that. Okay? So,
this is
1136. स्थूल शरीर अभिमानी जीव नामकं ब्रह्म प्रतिबिंबं भवति स एव जीवः प्रकृत्या स्वस्मात् ईश्वरं भिन्नत्वेन
जानाति
is, right, what is Jiva? Jiva, here he says that it is this awareness, okay, which actually has no boundary, okay, takes oneself to be what? Sthula Sharira Abhimani. Takes oneself to be
the body.
Right? And behaves as though
it is
right,
the body.
I'm as good as the body. When nobody says, nobody makes a statement, I'm the body, but people make the statement, I'm fat, I'm tall, I'm unfair. And people have, did you watch this NDTV? Recently there was this whole program on the, how Indians are obsessed with fairness. And they took
did you see that?
Oh my God, that was hilarious. So therefore, so this means that we are obsessive about it. Okay. So this is what we call Jiva. For Jiva, the I is not, it is not even awareness. What is it? It is as good as the physical body. The attributes of physical body and the attributes of mind are taken to be the nature of mind.
So it's basically saying this is a mistake.
This is as bad. So this is a Jiva. So that means all of us, until we solve this basic confusion, we are all Jivas. Because we live within that confusion.
So Jiva is that defined as?
What is Jiva?
Sthula is written. Sthula Sharira Abhimani. Your eye sense is in Sthula Sharira. Stula Sharira is in the physical body and also in subtle body. What is this sentence, the English sentence, one who is identified with the gross body called the Jiva is but the reflection of Brahman is...
Yeah.
So that means this awareness is nothing but Sat Chit Ananda. Awareness it is available to you. Okay? But this is the mistake that I was telling you. You impute on that awareness what the characteristics of the physical body. This is what I explained.
No, that I understood, but I don't understand the sentence.
Yeah, so Brahman means that Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma. Okay? Which is this awareness which is everywhere. But this awareness which is everywhere, in your body it is also there, and you take it to be what? That awareness to be Sthula Sharira. So this is what we call Jiva. Yeah, the terminology is something that you forget. This is what it means.
So that limiting the definition of the self to Jiva is the mistake.
So the Jiva is a stage at which you are making a mistake.
Yeah. Jiva is an entity. Jiva is you and me.
Yeah.
Forget about Jiva is you and me until you come to Vedanta. First of all, please understand, you don't even know I'm awareness. You don't even know. Right? If I ask you who are you, you will describe yourself by what?
My physical, name,
your physical, characteristic of your mind. This is what all of us are. Okay? So that means my whole identity is as good as what? I don't even know there is awareness, or nobody knows that there is awareness. Right? Everybody thinks that awareness which is there, self-evident, it gets what? Totally
becomes
loaded with the characteristic of your body and mind. This is how we are all.
So you're saying that Jiva is, as what Abhi was saying, that it's a stage of I, at which point we're still making this mistake, but in reality Jiva is limitless.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. So Nima, even when we're convinced by the logic that you give us, until we actually become and behave differently, we're still Jiva.
Yeah, so that means that the knowledge has not really
transformed
Jiva, not totally. So that means it takes time. For you to totally assimilate this knowledge and understand accurately what Vedanta is saying without projecting your own meanings, your own distortions, and also then taking care of the behavior part, until that whole thing happens, knowledge is not totally clear. You are in the process of knowledge.
So then, Jiva's existence is a physical, limited physical entity.
Jiva is an entity which is where the awareness which is available in your body, which is I, okay, is mistaken for what?
Your body mind.
Exactly. Simple. Okay. It gets what? I think that awareness, onto that awareness which is available to you as I, you impute the attributes of your physical body. So that means there is ignorance. What is there? There is ignorance about the nature.
Until we understand and assimilate the knowledge and alter our behavior accordingly.
Exactly. Absolutely. Right? So that means that Saha eva jiva prakrutya swasma ishvara bhinnatvena janati. So what is the orientation of this individual who takes oneself to be what? One body and one mind. One, the whole orientation of interaction with the universe is, I'm different from you, okay? You are different from me, the mountain is different from me.
Dualism.
Yeah, this is what we call Dvaita. Okay? The planets are different, the stars are different.
Mm.
Then I also say, Ishvara, the cause of the universe, where is it? Some uncle sitting somewhere to whom I have to just ask for mercy. Okay? That is vision of Jiva. Me, the individual, I'm only this much. Everybody else is different from me.
I'm separate.
The cause of the universe is also different from me. I'm separate. This is what we call that whole thing of isolation. You, the little one, fighting against the universe which is different for you. And constantly trying to manipulate the universe according to your wants.
You know, I've not understood the feeling of oneness.
It's not feeling, it's reality.
That reality I have not grasped at all.
So that is your seeing.
Yeah.
What is it that you have not grasped?
No, no, I'm just saying that this concept is still so alien. I mean, I'm understanding what you're saying intellectually, but I can't even begin to feel it.
Yeah. See, this is what I'm saying. It's not a matter of feeling. Okay? Feeling means what? Feeling keeps changing all the time. In one day, how many different feelings you have? Realities don't correspond with your feelings. They've got nothing to do with feelings. You can't say, oh, I understand intellectually that time and space is relative, but I can't feel it. It's not a matter of feeling.
Comprehending. Whatever the word is,
why what you need to do is really look at the realities totally differently. Align your thinking with what is being said. Try to understand. And it takes time. It's not something which just can happen overnight. But see the fact that what Vedanta says is uncontradictable. Okay? When you say, then you have no choice but to align your thinking with what is and not what you think is. There is no choice. We don't have a choice.
So what Nandita just said is that you understand yourself as a jiva, but when you align it with what is real and acknowledge and you apply it,
then
you become awareness, which is
no, you don't become awareness. You use awareness to move
become
towards freedom.
Sorry. This space, which seems to be confined to this, is it already free or is it not already free?
It is already free.
So that means, exactly, it appears to be confined, but it is already free.
It will exist with or without the glass.
Sorry?
It will exist with or without the glass.
Exactly. Even when the glass breaks, it's still there.
Yeah.
It's always there and it's always free. It's never conditioned by the glass. This is the reality of awareness. But what happens is, when I teach you Vedanta, your eye still continues to be somewhere else and you want to manipulate the eye to make it different. Because what Vedanta says and the meanings that are created in your mind, there is no alignment. So that means you continue to impute meanings onto Vedanta which don't exist. So that means you are not understanding it accurately. This is what I said, the problem is exactly. This is, you say, okay, now I have to do really work really hard to free this space.
It's already free.
It's already free. Oh, but I have to, this little space has to feel this whole sense of expansion in order to know that it is big. It's not available to you like that. Okay? All your expectations are not in keeping with reality. You're creating your realities. You're constantly projecting onto Vedanta your expectations. As long as that orientation remains, you'll never understand. Reality will keep eluding you. It is like saying, the minute I understand that the earth is a globe and not flat, my perception should change. Will your perception change when you understand that this earth is not flat but it is a globe? You will start seeing a curvature?
No.
Never. When you understand that the sun does not rise in the eastern sky but is stationary compared to the earth, the minute you understand, you think that the perception of sunrise will go away?
No.
In that very expectation that when I understand, my perception will change, that itself will keep you from understanding the reality. Because you are imputing certain things which will never happen.
You are extending the analogy of the space.
Yes.
So my awareness is not different from her awareness.
Yes.
It is just awareness. It is my thoughts and ideas which cause me to believe that my awareness is different from someone else's awareness.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Exactly. So that means that is a mistake. Absolutely. This awareness, which is confined to your body and seeming to be confined to your body and mind, is because of which you are seeing different conditions of your physical body and different conditions of your mind. Now, the mistake that you are making is that awareness you are taking to be as good as the body and mind. What Vedanta says is that this body and mind is something that you objectify, it's not you. You are that awareness which is free from the conditions of the physical body and mind. That is the first thing Vedanta says. Then it says, secondly, this awareness which you think is confined to the body and mind is actually not localized. It is free. Like here, it is free. It seems to be confined, but it is free. So that means, what you say is absolutely right. The bodies are different. Nobody is denying that. Okay? Minds are different. Nobody is denying that. But the awareness because of which different conditions of body and mind are known is not confined. It is one whole. That is what Atma is. Satyam Jnanam. Okay. As long as that awareness seems to be confined, not only confined to the body and mind, but onto that awareness you imbued attributes of physical body and mind, you're in Jiva. Jiva means you continue with the mistake.
So when you finish, when you understood the mistake, you reach the next stage, you become Atma.
It's not, see now there is, you are Atma. You are awareness.
No, but that's what you are referred to as Jiva, and actually
when you remove the ignorance,
then you are
totally,
reach the state
not
of
partially. See, it's not reaching a state also, it's just removing the ignorance. Seeing clearly what is, without adding my own interpretations. Exactly. Because even while you're trying to clear the mistake, you're removing one doubt, but you're creating another picture which doesn't exist.
That's why she gave that analogy of the perception, that you understand that it's not the sun that rises and sets. That doesn't
change.
It's a reality, yeah. You will continue to
see
the
exactly.
sun rising and setting, but you know the truth that it's the earth that's
going around.
Yeah.
Absolutely. What Saruni is saying
and
is that.
And then you understand that this is the law of nature. That it's the earth that's moving. Like laws
now,
exist.
Don't
you just remove your ignorance of them. Stop,
Jiva,
you create them.
Linear, absolutely.
Yeah. Atma.
Yeah.
Because that's what that
get the
doesn't exist.
Yeah,
it's
kind
yeah.
of
yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
See,
yeah.
what you think is when you understand, this is a very common problem people have, right? When you understand I'm limitless, then what? You will feel this whole big expansion of awareness. What are you doing? You are making awareness what?
An object
in time, space, and you are trying to expand it. That is so different from what Vedanta is telling you. You are making awareness into an object, another object.
Which is even worse.
Which is even worse.
To your body.
Exactly. See what I see? That when I give a meaning, people create the meanings which are sometimes appalling. Because this is what, after years and years and years of Vedanta, you can create your own meanings and get totally caught in those meanings and those expectations which make you further away from reality than what Vedanta is trying to show you. This is why if you need an excellent teacher who will detect those mistakes and tell you, hey, this is not what is said. Otherwise, you will be on a trip.
I think that might help you is later on they will come to label. So you do move from the jiva where we are to the jiva,
jiva mukta.
Yeah. That's the label maybe you're looking for. But you don't change the, you are already what you are.
You are what you are, it's just a label.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And we are constantly, see this is what you're going on telling us. See, we are constantly trying to understand awareness by confining it.
Exactly.
But that is the mistake that you are making.
Yes, absolutely. So that means you remove, okay, now after listening to Vedanta, you've taken away your awareness as attribute of body, but you're giving another
confinement.
So you're constantly moving from one picture to the other, from your imagination. Mind's imagination to imagine is infinite. Okay, this is why that whole preparation that we are talking about is what? Make a mind which is non-projecting mind. Because a mind which is a projecting mind, which is what a projecting mind, simple thing happens to me and I cannot handle and I'm angry with you. Okay? So that means there is one event which triggers a response in me which is like totally disproportionate to the event. That means a mind is adding meanings which are so much more than what actually the event calls for. With that kind of a mind, if you are listening to Vedanta and awareness, you will impute on awareness all kinds of your own stories which have got nothing to do with what Vedanta is talking about. So therefore, one of the preparation of Tattva Bodha is what? Make a mind which is a non-projecting mind. Is able to see things clearly. Is able to non-color. Exactly. Non-coloring mind is the first step to learning Vedanta. Because a coloring mind has a very fertile ground to go wild on one's imagination.
What is Vairagya?
So Vairagya. Vairagya is non-coloring mind. Non-coloring mind means you don't impute meanings which don't exist. You try to capture the reality as it is. Mm-hmm. So this person, the one who understands is who removes the ignorance, the veil of ignorance, and sees the reality exactly in keeping with what is.
So can we say when we know the truth about awareness, and then all the emotions of fear and jealousy and all those things slowly dissipate because we don't lay importance to what is more.
Now, what I will say it slightly the other way. What I would say is, until I have taken care of my fears, and until I have taken care of my sadness and anger and all that, which is a distortion, with that kind of a distorted mind, I cannot understand the reality.
You have to address it first.
So that means a precondition to knowing this reality is addressing it. This is why in Tattva Bodha, your maturity is the beginning. That is something which is a first step to understanding Vedanta. But what you are saying is absolutely right. What it means is that you need a certain preparation for Vedanta. Vedanta, when it gives you a certain vision, it will help you to deal with your subjectivity. And each will reinforce the other and start a positive kind
of virtuous circle. So this clears the path, clears the ignorance, clears the misconception.
So that clearing of ignorance is a process. It's a process because you have to prepare yourself not only by listening to Vedanta again and again and try to see what it says, but when you go out there, you also have to take care of what? All your angers, all your jealousies, all your fears, all your sadness, because in those things is distorted thinking. There is a lot of distorted thinking there. So unless you take care of all of that, right? Your mind is projecting more to events than what it has. The same mind is used for Vedanta, it will continue to project. Okay. And you will not understand accurately what is being said. So that means you do two things. One is listen to Vedanta again and again, and second what? Take care of your personal growth. It is two pursuits at the same time. self-discovery, which is knowing yourself to be much more than you ever imagined you were. The second is self-growth. Unless self-growth, which is what? Having certain kind of insight into your own psyche, which are your distortions. Undo those distortions. Unless you do that, that self-discovery will not happen.
I'm doing the distortions by seeing the reality of the situation, not putting your own
exactly
and all the variables that
exactly. So distinguishing between what is real and what is it that I'm adding to it, which is my imagination. Because a lot of your suffering in this world is
your own
imagination.
Your own adding.
You're adding. Because any situation, in fact, if you have a proper perspective, you can handle it. Everybody is given the capacity to handle. What becomes overwhelming is you get caught. So therefore, Jiva is who? The one who has mistaken what?
His awareness, his limitation to be his physical body and mind to be himself.
Exactly. Now, in the next class, we'll see what is Ishwara there.
But we won't be going into the further awareness from the Jiva, from the body into the genuine.
Yeah, but that
awareness.
already we did. I don't know if you all remember it. Atma was what? Satyam, Jnanam, Anantam, Brahma. We've already seen that. But when this text is over, when we start another text, the whole thing will be uploaded again. Yeah.
I think I've missed quite a lot.
Yeah, you missed quite a lot, obviously. Because they've started since I don't know when.
But you can see it as I said on the
video.
You can see it on the video.
Not Nima's website.
Yeah, even my website.
This is on your website.
I think it's a live stream.
It's a live stream, and this is available on my website.
Just be looking at our website.
Was it really nice? You can't see it.
Oh, just something. This is all.
She's born. She's born. Namadam. Born. Namidam. Born. Born. Namadachate. Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.